So we'll carry forward. Karan, hi Karan, welcome. Vaibhav Parekh, Nishchal Joshipura, and Ruchisia. So Karan, once again, to tell you, he is Indian Council, Private Equity, Bisama Venture Partners. And Vaibhav is a partner in charge of private equity, mergers and acquisition at our firm. Nishchal, again, is also a partner in private equity and M&A. And Ruchi Rusia is private equity and private debt, particularly. I think we should always start with our guest. So Karan, I think you are the opening batsman. What's your experience in India, and what are your thoughts on investing in New India?
So that's a tough question. As an opening batsman, I hope I do better than the Indian cricket team has been doing in England for the past few months. But in terms of opportunities, there are a lot of opportunities in India. So we have not struggled to find companies we think are worth investing in. I think if I had one standout comment, being a lawyer, I think that probably judges my vision as well. It's that I think the certainty in the regulatory and tax framework in India really falls far short of what international investors expect. And you often end up guessing on what is allowed and what is not allowed. And you spend a lot of time troubling people like Nishchal and Vyapak, you know. And sometimes I feel more than you ought to or should need to when you're actually getting a deal done. And it sort of cuts across almost all aspects of deal making. You know, from the start when you set up the fund and you're considering whether you're going to be eligible for treaty benefits, you know, when you start investing and you start considering if a sector is eligible for investment or not, you constantly come up against hurdles where you just don't know. You know, it's possible to deal with situations where you get simple yes and no answers. I think where we really sometimes feel there's scope for improvement is if you just had a simple yes or no answer, so that you could take a decision accordingly. I think that's my main, if I had to point out area of improvement, I think that would be it. In terms of opportunities, as I mentioned, I think there are lots of opportunities. It's a competitive environment. You have to do well. You have to get your term sheets out faster. You have to give better valuations. Exit environment is tough, but you know, if you make the right choices, you can succeed. I think it's that uncertainty when you actually evaluate the investments, especially around regulatory and tax, which leaves you a little, hoping for more certainty.
Thank you. Ruchi, wake up. What are the regulatory frameworks governing the portfolio debt investment? Have you done a lot of network?
Yeah, sure. No, I think Pratibha already discussed the foreign portfolio investment regime. And I think we always talk about foreign equity investments. I think there's a sizable portion of foreign debt inflows also coming into India. And the government is trying to encourage that market much as possible. And I think a portion of those foreign debt inflows is you know, what constitutes private debt or structured debt instruments. Now, what is really private debt or structured debt instruments, you know? India has opened up to foreign debt like it never had in the past couple of years. We structured, you know, we pioneered this instrument called as, you know, the listed non-convertible bonds or the listed non-convertible debentures in 2008. There was a time when, you know, we only had very dominant equity markets, but we hardly had a debt capital market. And that time, 2008, you know, the government came up and simplified the debt issue regulations and said, you know, please come and invest into bonds, because globally about, you know, a substantial amount of portion, 35 to 40% is corporate bonds, but you know, in India, whenever someone needs or financing or you know, needs leverage, the only way is for him to approach the banks. There's hardly a corporate bond market. So that's how this developed in 2008, when the government simplified the debt issue regulations. And today the situation is that any Indian corporate, even a brand new company which is one day old, can issue non-convertible debentures or non-convertible bonds to a non-resident, which should be listed within 15 days' time. Now, who can be this non-resident? It can today be a foreign portfolio investor But as I think Pratibha mentioned today, the norms have been so deregulated that there is no requirement of foreign portfolio investor being a regulated body or being registered with the SEBI. Any individual or any foreign body corporate can register itself as a foreign portfolio investment in investor category 3, and it does not need any registration with the SEBI. Now, what are the benefits really of this private and who's doing it? Can I please direct you to open or request you to open this book? It's called Private Equity and Private Debt Investments. Please look at page 15. Look at other pages also. I think we've spent a lot of time doing this, but look at page 15.
It's like appearing
for
in the court, you know.
but look at page 15. It talks about private debt investment, and some of the benefits of this is given on page 16. So what are the benefits really? I think the largest benefit today is from a tax perspective, especially for asset classes where there is a constant cash upstreaming required. Because today, let's say, I think Saurabh was mentioning about infrastructure, 16%, 18% IRR, and cash being upstreamed from the project. Now, how do you upstream? Because when you have to upstream, the company has to first book revenues on which it pays income tax. And then when it distributes, it has to pay distribution taxes of 15% on dividends, 20% on buybacks, and all that. Instead, if you do this by way of this private, or this private debt or the non-convertible bonds, all that you pay on top of your debentures is actually deductible for the Indian company. And there's a withholding tax which can go as low as just 5% in India for which you receive a credit. So it's extremely tax optimized. Instead of 45% tax leakage or 50% tax leakage, you're talking about a substantial deduction over here. The other benefit is that, and the way we structure these bonds, is that they, in many ways, function like a form of structured equity, which means your returns on the bond can be linked through a proportion of redemption premium and coupon to the performance of the company. It could be linked to EBITDA, it could be linked to cash flows. In a sense, what it means is that if you make more, you pay more. If you don't make more, you don't pay that much, right? So essentially, giving you downside protections with equity upsides. So that's the way it is being used. Another benefit is it is not subjected to the sectoral restrictions that FDI is subjected to. So many sectors like insurance or multi-brand retail or things like that, because this is portfolio investment, it is not subjected to FDI. So in those sectors, you could invest through these bonds, getting the same economic returns, and to some extent also negative rights. Because you are technically a lender, so you can have all affirmative rights that you want. You may not be able to drive the company, but vetoes you can have as many. So you get vetoes, you get economic rights, just as you would have if you were investing through equity. Another structure where we have seen this is, and which is becoming popular, is in case of promoter financing. You invest into a promoter company, which in turn uses that money to buy listed equity, and your returns on the bond are pegged to the underlying equity. So it's a pipe of some sort. Depends on how you want to position it. I think another reason why it's becoming, I think it's become the norm in the real estate sector, in fact, some of the other sectors which are asset heavy, to use these kind of structures, is security creation. Today, I think as discussed in the first panel, the challenge is not capital appreciation, but really capital protection. You need to protect what you have. That's probably the first part. Many people are even losing their capital. So I think this provides you with capital protection. It allows you to create security interest in form of mortgage, in form of pledge, or whatever, guarantees. These days, funds are getting creative. Some of the real estate funds take the guarantees of the promoter's wife. So it depends to what extent you want to go. And you can create all kind of security interest to an onshore security trustee, and he would enforce the security on your behalf. So you have got all the teeth that you need, you've got the equity upside, and you have tax optimization. So I think that is a structure which we're seeing increasingly.
Thank you so much for a good elaboration on the whole, framework for the debt investments. Weibo, what are the aspects to be considered from the perspective of Companies Act 2013 and some recent developments in exchange control regulations? But if you can give a quick update, that would be very helpful.
Sure. One thing, Ruchir, you forgot to mention that you don't need to worry about the new Companies Act too much, especially the preferential issue and that kind of on equity and CCPS. But anyway, I'll tell you quickly, I think fundamentally the New Companies Act has done exactly what Karan said government should not do, brought in more uncertainty. Also, two biggest changes they have brought in. One, they have reduced differentiation between a private company and a public company. You know, earlier when you had investment and you invested in a private company, it was animal which you could control, you could do anything which you wanted. Most of the flexibility was there. A lot of flexibility has been taken away. Secondly, it has increased liabilities, including liability for directors. Now, if you really see this, the uncertainty which has brought it in my view, it will take at least 2 years before you will see some semblance of certainty where when you meet 10 experts, all 10 experts will say the same thing. Today when you meet any expert, or you will have 10 different answers for 10 same question, because there are multiple interpretations which are possible. All judicial precedents, or several judicial precedents which kind of defined new old Companies Act over several years, 40 years, has actually disappeared. The clarifications which are coming out, and we are seeing more and more clarifications are coming out, are creating more confusion. To an extent where I was speaking to someone on Friday and he said he's actually considering to file a public interest litigation to scrap New Companies Act 2013 and bring back the 1956 Act. So unfortunately, the new act, in spite of good intention of the government, the way it is drafted and the way it was conceptualized, trying to kind of overcome all the scams which had happened over a period of time and trying to plug the holes, they made it so restrictive that it is a little difficult now for a lot of companies to do business. Now, having said it, how does it affect private equity investment? And I will put this into three categories. Let's say first category is, let's say you are entering into a company. Let's take first question is, what price can you enter? You know, in earlier, before New Companies Act, if you're a foreign investor, you knew that you need to meet the minimum pricing guidelines from RBI and that's it. Otherwise, you are free to go and do any deal which you could. If you're Indian investor, there was no issue whatsoever on pricing other than tax 56, where you would see whether it's taxable or not, if you're not exempt. Now, under Section 62 of Companies Act, you can only issue shares at the price on the basis of independent valuer. Now, what does in the basis of independent valuer mean? Does it mean exactly the same price? Does it mean it can be below 5% or more than 5%? Exactly what does it mean? So there were a lot of confusion at that level, and then came a circular which says that, look, you can issue as long as it is not less than the value of the price with the valuation was done. Again, when you read the circular, when you read the act itself, there is little ambiguity to say whether I can really go very high if the price as per the value or it's 100 rupees, can I really go to 200 rupees, 300 rupees, or I have less freedom to do it. But let's assume that today we can go, and our view is that because of the circular, maybe we can go and as the days were earlier where the pricing guidelines is the minimum guidelines, and you can invest anywhere above that particular price at which the valuer has valued. Then the next question comes is, can I have a convertible instrument which will convert at a future date? See, one of the common things which you used to do before is that I will put money in today, get a convertible instrument which I will convert it, let's say as per EBITDA of 2015 finance, or as per revenue of 2016. You know, now the question is whether I can do it or not. One of the requirement under New Companies Act is that you have to, if you are having a convertible instrument, then you need to specify the conversion ratio. There is no specific provision where you can do a formula. And again, if you look back to the concept that I need to do it at a particular price or based on a particular valuation, then whether I can actually provide a formula or not, there's an ambiguity there. Our view is that you should be able to do it as long as that's been taken care of at the time of valuation. If you provided formula, I think you should be able to do it. But there is still an uncertainty which remains. Now, if I am not able to do a convertible formula, then next question comes is, can I really enforce my anti-dilution rights? Because anti-dilution rights is some of the essential protection you seek and you expect when you make an investment. And your anti-dilution right, if you are a foreign investor, or if you're investing as a convertible price where you expect to get anti-dilution right by adjusting the conversion formula or getting shares issued at a very par value or low cost. Now, that route, if it is closed, then how can you really enforce anti-dilution right? So that again gets into a question whether I can do it or not. We believe that next couple of years and as things goes by, we will get certainty, but till we get there, I think we can do it. There is some case for it. There is not absolute case or absolute certainty, but I think we can do it.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
You want me to?
We are running short, but why don't you take a minute?
Let me add a couple of other points on this. The second point is with respect to, let's say, on preferential allotment. Question comes, should I do it? What we are seeing more is that people are using rights issue today as opposed to preferential allotment issue, because one of the issues on preferential allotment, what I mentioned on the price and other stuff goes away, or disclosure norm goes away, if I do as a rights issue. And while that has been acceptable practice, market practice today, the big question there is, will government treat this as a scam? Because a lot of time people will sign a term sheet with the investor, then say we want to do rights issue, and then do all the board resolutions for the rights issue. Now this creates a lot of problem in future if government views that all you did was a preferential issue using a rights mechanism. So our advice has been that, look, if you are really looking at a rights issue, you do a rights issue. If you don't get subscription from your existing investors, then go ahead and use that shares for preferential allotment, but don't do vice versa. Don't sign the term sheet and then do a rights issue. I think this, I can leave it.
Yeah. Sorry for, pushing the timeline, but I think next question I'll ask is to Nishchal. Once again, he leads our private equity M&A space. But a simple way, what are the do's and don'ts from a documentation perspective? What have you seen? Which the fund should keep in mind at the time of investment in a portfolio company? Thank you.
Sure. So without going into the specifics of each clause of the investment agreement, I think a couple of things have evolved in the last couple of years. One is, have you made your investment document GAR proof? And the second is, have you made your investment document litigation proof? The reason why GAR has become so important is a lot of people think that GAR is going to be effective from 1st of April 2015. But the fact is that all the structures which have been set up post August 30, 2010, if the income is arising from any of those structures post 1st April 2015, are going to be subject to GAR scrutiny. And that's where it becomes very important that all your investment documents which you have signed post August 30, 2010, do you have sufficient commercial justification which you have built in your documentation, especially the recitals of the document, to substantiate and commercially justify each and every step of the transaction and the structure? And that is where it becomes important that the lawyer who is drafting your agreement also has some tax knowledge. What typically we have found is that the tax advisors come up with fancy structures, and at the time when the documents need to be drafted, some of the nuances of the structure are not properly reflected in the agreements, because of which the tax authorities are able to identify the loopholes in the document and subject some of these agreements and the structures to GAR scrutiny. So this is one very important point. In fact, some of you may have this experience. Since 2012, when any foreign investor is investing in an Indian company which is subject to government approval route, there is a long list of questions which FIPB sends on who are the ultimate beneficiaries of your structure, right? The problem with that is these questions are sent by a CBDT official who is sitting on FIPB board. And the way these questions are drafted are in a way, it could also be a kind of trap from the tax authorities, because The question is, who are the ultimate beneficiaries of the structure? It's very natural to respond in the same manner in which the question has been asked. So the way you will respond is, let's say a typical structure that you have is you have US LPs who have invested in a Cayman or a Delaware fund, and a Cayman Delaware fund have invested in a Mauritius company, and Mauritius company is applying to FIPB for approval to invest in the portfolio company in India. The moment you respond that the ultimate beneficiaries are XYZ LPs, one of the risks that you carry in future when you exit from that portfolio company is that the tax authorities might say that you yourself admitted in the FIPB application that the ultimate beneficiaries of the structure are sitting in US, then why should I give you the treaty benefits between India and Mauritius or India and Singapore? So that's something, how you respond is also very critical when you are liaising with the authorities other than the tax authorities. Second important thing which I mentioned is your document litigation proof? 5 years back, it was not that critical. And the reason for that is there were not many private equity disputes in India, but because of the global recession and India not being able to provide sufficient exits, there have been a lot of disputes between the investors and the promoters. Now, what has become very important is, at the time when you are drafting the investment agreement, have you envisaged all types of situations or the worst case scenarios? Like, what if there is siphoning of funds by the promoters? What if the promoter doesn't honor the put option? What if the promoter takes certain decisions on reserved matters without my approval? Some of these things need to be factored in the agreement upfront, because typically what happens is the agreements are drafted by corporate lawyers. 2-3 years go by when, you know, the honeymoon period is going on between the private equity investor and the promoter. And suddenly after a few years, they realize there is a exit is not happening and, you know, dispute starts. At that time, the litigation lawyers take over and they realize that the document was not drafted in the manner in which it should have been drafted from a litigation perspective. So it's become very important that when you are drafting the investment agreement, involve the litigation team and ensure that all the clauses which are required to safeguard you in future are factored in the first agreement which is sent to the other side. So broadly, in nutshell, I think it's, as I mentioned, from a documentation perspective, ensure that at the time of investment, your document is both GAR proof and litigation proof.
Thank you so much. And litigation, we thought this was not a part of the industry, you know, very little some years ago. But last few years, we have seen so much of it, you know, and it's very difficult to handle, it's very expensive. So it is important to understand how, you know, most of the time we see that last clauses relating to arbitration and stuff like that are inadequately drafted. And I think we'll deal with that in the last session. I would suggest that you please stay on, because most people ignore litigation, whereas you must know something about litigation. Number two, that's why we added that particular session. And other thing is that what a PE player should know about criminal law, because nowadays we see a lot of criminal proceedings coming up against fund managers or directors and stuff like that. It would be useful to, you know, understand something about it. Otherwise, somebody comes up at your door, you don't know what to do next. Okay. But anyway, that leave aside for a moment. But Karan, what does it take to achieve successful exits in India? You got quite a few of them done, so, and you know a good deal about it, so please tell us.
I think the most important thing is picking the right company. That invariably is your best bet. If you have the right company, you'll have a good exit. But
very easy answer, huh?
Yeah, that's
very
that's
easy
just,
answer.
Yeah, that's the first.
How to pick up a good company?
No, but on a more serious note, I think you need to really think through, you know, what kind of exit you're looking at, because there are three kinds of exits largely. You know, you have exits in a public offering that has a whole bunch of issues. You have exits where the company is sold to a strategic player, you know, that has a completely different range of issues. And then you have the final category where an investor sells out to perhaps another financial investor, one fund selling to another fund somewhere along the way from seed to going public. And the considerations tend to be very different, you know, in all three. And I think it's appropriate when you're first investing to assess each of these situations, which is the most likely outcome. And you know, at some level, what you write in the documents when you first invest is crystal ball gazing. It's not always going to come play out exactly as you imagine, but if you put in place an enabling framework, we found that helps get everybody on the table, you know, at the same mind space when you're starting to think through exits and you're not coming at it from completely diametric positions when current situations. Now, when you're looking at public offerings, there is a new sort of trend, which is to try and go public in the US. And that hasn't happened for a long time because of regulatory reasons in India, where you essentially could not go public in the US unless you were already listed in India, which made it very difficult for these venture fund or private equity backed companies which were unlisted, because the extent of dilution by dual listing was just not practical. Now the rules have changed. Going back to my first comment, they're still not certain. No one really knows how you're supposed to navigate these rules to do dual listing. Some funds have set up offshore structures where they're investing into Singapore SPVs or Cayman SPVs. If you're inclined to consider those options, my suggestion, and I'm sure Nischal will echo this wholeheartedly, is do it when you first invest. That's the best time to do it. It's when the valuations are somewhat in control and the tax issues are likely to be the lowest. So you have to take that decision very early on. If you let the company grow to a critical size, offshoring is going to be very tricky. And if you're looking at then listing overseas, you are sort of reliant on the Indian regulators being able to actually provide an enabling framework to do that. For the other two, which is your strategic M&A exit and you know, your selling out to another financial investor, again, my suggestion would be have a conversation early on around time frames when people will start thinking of looking for strategic investors. You know, are the founders inclined to sell the business? Because you have two kinds of founders, you know, the ones who want to stay with the company forever and the others who are also looking to do something for 5 or 7 years and then leave themselves, maybe sell out to a bigger company. Have those discussions as early as you can. Of course, there's no guarantee that 5 years down the line you'll be doing whatever you had discussed 5 years ago, but it helps just bringing everybody onto the same page. And you know, drafting the documents and getting all that stuff in place provides a nice framework for everyone to sort of consider these issues when they come up. But Nishit bhai, if you don't mind,
sure.
On the topic which Vaibhav touched on, that's a pet peeve of mine, the new Companies Act. And just one thing which he didn't mention, but which I find incredulous and actually kind of funny.
I cut him off, so yeah. You know, you
so
can take
I,
it.
I'm sure it's there in his list.
So. I had a long list. Gave like presentation of 2.5 hours on Friday.
Yeah. But the funny one,
summarized in 5 minutes.
Yeah. The comical one, which has to be on his list because I think it's on most people's first list, is that if you just see a plain reading of the section, it would suggest that you can be guilty of insider trading in unlisted companies. Which effectively means that even when you invest in an unlisted company, you have to think twice before doing a diligence or making this information available to the public. You really don't know who the public is for an unlisted company. I think that piece of legislation is really unfortunate. You know, after all these years, they had a chance to redraft that Companies Act, and then they went and produced something which is really not well thought through. I don't know if they relied on experts to come up with some of those sections. It doesn't take a lot to add a clarification into a section saying that this will not apply to unlisted securities. It's a real shame. It's very unfortunate, and the uncertainty it's created is just unbelievable when you actually start doing deals. You know, small things which you laugh at on a seminar like this, when you actually have to pull the plug and wire the money and someone tells you that, oh, technically you may be guilty of insider trading. You know, it's not funny at that point
of time.
True. And it's unfortunate that the law has been drafted as poorly.
Even insider trading, I believe, is extended to private companies.
That's what Karan mentioned. But, you know, Karan,
right.
On serious note, actually it was intentional. If you see section 468, they specifically mentioned that for public company it will be SEBI and for others it will be MCA. So it was intended to for unlisted companies, but though it's only listed, only public companies.
That makes it even more unfortunate, if anything, because that means they were deliberately being, you know, non-cooperative for lack of a better expression, but
No, actually in the US we have seen cases where what happened in private companies, say one of the founders or one of the shareholders, you know, he would be asked, okay, let us settle and you go out, you know, he is exiting from the company. But at that point of time, some other partners were negotiating acquisition of a company, even a private company. So there was not full disclosure to the partner. And therefore, that partner would bring a lawsuit on the company, other founders, saying that you did not represent everything to me. Therefore, I sold you at this price. And therefore, now you're gone after a few months. At the point of time you negotiated with me my exit, you never told me what actually you're doing. So because of that. So those kind of situations have existed, even otherwise it could have happened here also. That's one side point. But let me extend this discussion a little bit on the exit, so because that's very critical. And Nishal, maybe you can tell about some evolving exit strategies or structures, and also some tax issues in structuring exits, if you can talk a little bit. We have about, next about 12, 13 minutes, if you can take a few minutes, and then we have question answers so that people have an opportunity to participate.
Sure. So as Karan mentioned, just like the Companies Act, exit has also become a four-letter word for the LPs and the GPs in India. Primarily because of the fact that one is the exits are anyways difficult because of the status of the capital market and the trade sales are also not happening. But more importantly, the tax uncertainty, which is plaguing the exits further. As some of you may be aware, when a foreign fund is exiting from India, it's a taxable transaction in India if any capital gains arise from the transfer of shares. Now, the only way this capital gains can be reduced is if you are eligible for a treaty benefit between the jurisdiction from where the foreign fund is investing and India. Now, the problem which has been facing the funds is that under the Indian Income Tax Act, when an Indian resident or a foreign resident pays any consideration for transfer of shares to a foreign seller, there is a requirement to withhold tax, and that liability or responsibility is of the payer and not the recipient, which is where the biggest issue comes up, because the structures where the Mauritius fund is selling shares in an Indian company, unless an Indian buyer or a non-resident buyer is buying, the first issue which comes up is, will the Mauritius treaty be respected by the tax authorities when they're actually looking at the assessment of the Mauritius entity which has exited from the Indian company. The problem is, we have a famous landmark ruling of Supreme Court on Azadi Bachao Andolan, which was pronounced in 2004. And in a way, it's still the law of the land, where Mauritius sellers, as long as they have a tax residency certificate, they should be allowed treaty benefits. But unfortunately, the tax authorities have started raising issues on substance and colorable device and some of those things, which have started creating ambiguities for both the buyer and the seller. Now, the way buyer thinks is that the seller is earning capital gains. Why should I bear the brunt of any tax if the tax authorities impose in future? So what happens is, the negotiations start. The seller doesn't want the buyer to withhold tax. The buyer wants to be 100% sure, because it's not his tax and he's paying the seller, and after the deal is done, the seller and the buyer are, apart from the agreement that they negotiate, there is not much recourse with the buyer as against the seller. So there are few structures, or rather few arrangements, which have evolved over a period of time. I think the classic one earlier, before 3-4 years, was tax indemnity, which the seller used to give to the buyer, that in case the tax authorities come after you, I will indemnify you for the taxes plus interest and penalty. Unfortunately, that became an issue, because most of these private equity funds have a limited life, and most of them are exiting at the fag end of the fund life. So if you have to exit, if you are exiting just 2 or 3 years before the end of the fund life, and the tax authorities pretty much have full time to chase the buyer to collect the taxes, how do you recover the taxes as a buyer from the seller after the end of the fund life? So that became a big issue with the exits happening in the last 2-3 years. And then what happened was, tax insurance as a product became very popular. So there are these insurance companies which insure the taxes in case the tax authorities raise a demand in future. So you pay a certain premium and neither the buyer nor the seller, they have to pay any tax. Unfortunately, on that front also, the insurance companies face some issues on the bandwidth which is available for the giving the insurance cover. So that's again another issue, but broadly the insurance has worked out quite well. Couple of other ways in which to manage the tax risk has been advance ruling mechanism. You can approach the advance tax ruling authority to give a pronounced ruling on whether the transaction is taxable or not, and depending on the outcome, the parties decide whether to whether the seller should remit the money to the buyer or not. We have also seen the concept of escrow in one-off transaction and liquid reserve account, which is very common for overseas transactions. So broadly, some of these tax uncertainties have been plaguing the exits, which anyways are difficult in India. And what we have seen on account of some of these issues is some of the new structures which are evolving. Like Karan mentioned, one of the structures which has become quite popular in the last few years is what we call the externalization structure, where you flip the shareholding of Indian company outside India, let's say to Singapore or Switzerland, depending on the customer base and the type of revenues that you are earning. So what happens is that the entire shareholding of Indian company is replicated in a foreign company, and all the investors, especially the private equity funds, come into that foreign company. So one is you change your, let's say it's an IT company which has its revenues or major customers from outside India, let's say from the US, then you change the business model in a manner where the Indian company becomes a cost center and your foreign company becomes a revenue center, and you just compensate the Indian company on an arm's length basis. So as a private equity investor, the comfort that you have is you are exiting, you are investing in dollars, you are exiting in dollars. So you are not taking the exchange fluctuation risk in India. The second advantage that you have is the listing becomes extremely simple. Today, what India has done is we have exported our capital markets. If you look at IT, e-commerce, NASDAQ is the market. If you look at mines, minerals, people go to AIIMS. If you look at real estate or hotels, hospitals, SGX is the market. So what India has done is, just like IT services, it has also exported the capital markets, which is why having an offshore company which holds the Indian company becomes comes very handy at the time of listing. You can just list your Singapore or Swiss company on NASDAQ. And one more advantage is that we just set up one structure in Switzerland where you can actually negotiate your tax rates with the tax authorities in Switzerland as a taxpayer. So we managed to negotiate about 6 to 8% tax rate, which will be the total tax rate you have to pay in Switzerland. So look at that structure where you are just paying 6 to 8% tax in Switzerland, and you have the opportunity to list on NASDAQ or some of the other markets. So, you know, there is so much flexibility which you get outside India as compared to when you are directly investing in India. So broadly, the theme which we have been seeing as far as private equity investors are concerned is they are interested in Indian businesses, but they prefer to invest in foreign companies holding Indian businesses. So that's what we are seeing.
I think what Nishal mentioned is probably one of the ways, you know, where you flip the holding. There's also the regime that Karan was mentioning, where an Indian company now can list overseas without being listed in India through the depository receipt mechanism. And I think that is a structure which I think would probably be the most, as you know, as I would like to call it, GAR sanitized. Because what a foreign investor could do, they could subscribe to depository receipts of an Indian unlisted company on, let's say, SGX or NYSE or NASDAQ, wherever, and have the same level of affirmative rights or whatever through depository mechanisms on the Indian company. Now, the important part is, while you get all the benefits of listing, valuation, and all of that, when you're exiting on the floor of the exchange in NYSE or NASDAQ, there is no tax in India. Because you don't have to prove any substance that, you know, you're coming from Mauritius or Singapore, because once you're selling it on the floor of the exchange, the Indian domestic tax law itself exempts for any tax. Right, so there's no tax issue or there's no GAR issue which you would still grapple with in you know, an externalization, you know, kind of structures where you're having offshore holding companies in Switzerland, wherever, you know, because typically you would hold the Swiss company also through another jurisdiction to avoid India, you know, Switzerland taxes. So I think that is an important part, and I think I'll probably again, if you are interested in more of this, this is page 73 of this book on private equity, which talks about externalization and offshore listing structures.
So thank you. It was very interesting. And let's open up to the questions now. Anybody has any question here? Yes, please tell your name and.
Hi, this is Prachi from CIF India Agribusiness Fund. I have a question for Nishil. You spoke about the flipping of shareholding and there should be substance at the Mauritius level or whichever jurisdiction level. So is it possible that even though I don't have a substance at the international level, I can still swap the holding through a swap ratio by doing something, or I really need to have substance there?
It's a very complicated structure which you have to do. Obviously, it's just mere swapping will not work because swapping will have a lot of phantom tax that you have to pay. You are not getting any cash, but you have to still pay tax. So there are a couple of structures which, you know, we can discuss offline. It won't happen in next 1 minute, which we can discuss. But I think clearly, as far as substance is concerned, you will have to establish substance. And that's where in the externalization model, typically the holding company of the Indian company or the 100% parent of Indian company, we always ensure that the contracts by the overseas customers are entered into by those companies.
So in a way, a company which is not an export-oriented company can never use this structure.
That's
in
true,
a way,
because
so
then
because
it doesn't make too much sense to flip it.
Okay, understood. Thanks.
Anyone on the phone, maybe?
Sure, sir. Participants on the audio bridge, if you would like to ask a question, please press star and one at this time. We have a question from the line of Vikas Sada from Unitas Capital. Please go ahead.
Sometime back we spoke about structuring for the getting debt fund into India, the NCDs, and also I think generally the Netherlands or Luxembourg route is used. I think mostly Luxembourg. So currently, I met few people who have faced some benefit of, I think, limitation of benefit clause in the treaty. So I just wanted to check, are people still using these routes or what is preferable?
Sorry, I think you just cut off in between, but I think your question is, for these kind of listed NCD structures, people are using Netherlands or Luxembourg, or is there any other preference? And I think you mentioned something about limitation of benefits.
So you spoke about limitation of benefits article in treaties. There is a specific carve out for companies that are listed overseas, but it is just not listing. It is in some treaties, depending on the language of the limitation of treaty benefit article, it would also say that it should be listed and traded. That, so one could be listed, that itself may not be excluded. Some treaties don't have the word called regularly traded.
I was talking more from, so say, forget about the listing, so it's basically bringing debt capital into India. Then the Luxembourg and Netherlands, and then the limitation of benefit clause.
So I'll answer your question. I think typically for debt, you use Luxembourg, Netherlands, or Singapore. Both in case of Luxembourg and Netherlands, the withholding tax is only 10%. In Singapore, it is 15%. And in Singapore, the limitation of benefits treaty, et cetera, do not apply for debt. Even in case of Netherlands and Luxembourg, there is no LOB provision. So you can choose either of these jurisdictions. Netherlands is typically, we have used Netherlands extensively for the ease of setting it up, but I think Luxembourg is also coming up in a good way. They both are equally good jurisdictions. With Netherlands, you have to look at some of the recent NDIAPU's provisions that have recently been introduced, and we can discuss that offline. In fact, everything about the NDIAPU's provisions, etc., are in the literature that we have here. We'll have it sent out to you.
Okay. Any question here on the ground in the room? Probably none. Okay. Anyone on the phone? Then we'll close this session because it's already, we are 3 minutes or two minutes off. So you are very good. So we have very few questions. So it was very clear. Thank you so much for our cooperation.